Good afternoon or good morning, everybody, wherever you are. Welcome to our webinar on innovative approaches for managing professional growth, the second part of our two-part webinar. My name is Norm Bailey-David. I'm Senior Vice President of Engagement at TalentMap, and I'll be accompanied by Matt Rakowski, our Regional Sales Director here for the Eastern Region. Today, what we're going to do is really continue the webinar that we began last week. Last week, I spoke about the challenge that many organizations face in dealing with professional growth. And I'm going to basically pick it up where I left off and really give you three best practices that many of our clients and many in the literature have been using to address some of the challenges that have been put forward in terms of professional growth. And these are job crafting, job shadowing, and I'll talk also about some trends and some best practices in learning and development, because let's face it, learning and development, training is really key in terms of professional growth, especially when we can't provide our employees with all of the career advancement that they might feel they want and deserve. And then, of course, we'll have time afterwards for some Q&A. Before I get into that, essentially what I'd just like to do is, for those of you who don't know TalentMap, just give you a brief introduction into who we are. We've been around for about 15 years, actually a little bit more than that by now, something more like 18. We've done more than 7,000 employee engagement surveys. Essentially, we focus exclusively on workforce engagement surveys. So employee engagement being the main type, but we also do safety, culture, diversity and inclusion. We do 360s. We do entry or onboarding surveys and exit surveys as well, but we focus exclusively on the workforce engagement survey. So here's just a quick snapshot of some of the clients, some of the many clients that we deal with in different sectors. You can see here we have a broad range of experience gained in health sciences and financial services and not-for-profits, technology and engineering, really a diverse view of the Canadian economy and American economies as well. So let's look back at the professional growth challenge, the way we saw it essentially in the last webinar, just to give those of you who didn't participate in that webinar a little bit of a refresher, and then we'll move into some of those techniques that I was talking about. So as I basically indicated last month, professional growth is by far and away the single most important driver of engagement. What does that mean? Well, basically that means in all of the different dimensions that we know have some influence on employee engagement, professional growth accounts for the greatest part. So the percentages that you see here on this slide, which have been taken essentially from our benchmark database, which contains more than 150,000 people who have answered the employee engagement surveys, the professional growth accounts for 17% of that employee engagement pie. If we want to think about engagement as an overall pie, and each of those survey dimensions that you see on the screen in front of you account for some portion of that. Well, professional growth accounts for the greatest portion. Why is that important? Well, that's because essentially if we take action to improve employees' perception of their professional growth prospects in our organization, we're going to have the single biggest impact on our employee engagement. Take that in contrast to something like performance feedback you see on the bottom of the screen, which only accounts for about 4%. So if we take equal effort in trying to improve our performance feedback process, even if it's something that's troublesome in our own organization, we're only going to influence roughly around 4%. Now, keep in mind, these are generic economy-wide numbers, and for each organization, once you do a survey, you should have this particular fingerprint for your organization, which will differ slightly. However, overall, we can safely say that professional growth, both in most organizations and by the greatest number, is the single most important engagement driver. So what you're looking at here essentially is a typical client example, what it looks like. When we're measuring professional growth, we measure five attitudes towards professional growth. And you can clearly see on the screen the Achilles heel of learning and growth and career aspirations. And essentially what that's telling us is by improving on these two particular items, these two particular attitudes, we can improve professional growth, our employees' perceptions thereof. And of course, by doing so, I've already shown you that that'll have the biggest impact on engagement. So the career aspiration side, which is obviously the biggest challenge in this particular example, is also the one that's most difficult to address directly. Why? Well, because most organizations, even the largest organizations, simply don't have enough boxes, let's put it that way, in their pyramids, in their organizational charts, the positions to be filled at the higher levels. The organizational pyramid, as we used to know it, is fast disappearing, and organizations have become much flatter. And so we've cut out management ranks, we've cut out different layers in our organizations, leaving, of course, a lot fewer opportunities for employees to take those promotions. So for every, roughly speaking, for every five employees that we have, we've only got one promotion available for each of those. So obviously that's going to represent a challenge in terms of how we provide career or future career for that organization. But as you can see, I mean, all of the research and all of our questionnaires show that that is only one aspect of professional growth. Employees want challenging work. They want to work to their potential. They want to make a difference. And most importantly, they want to learn and grow. So how then can we keep employees engaged, even if we can't give them the opportunities that we would like to give them? How can we keep them engaged in our organization while they're still with us before they move on to that next opportunity? The last month I talked about four different ways. I'm going to just speak about or remind you about one in particular, and that's career management. And I alluded to that just before in terms of looking for how we manage one's career given the fact that we don't have the professional growth opportunities or promotion opportunities available. And the way we can do that essentially is through something called career management. Now, most organizations still focus on performance management. Well, performance management is really a rear view mirror image of the employee's contribution to the organization. It looks at the past year. It appraises the strengths and weaknesses. It focuses on specific KPIs or results that happened previously, and then it basically rolls all that up into an annual conversation, sometimes a few more than that, but most often it's still the annual performance appraisal, and essentially says, well, okay, well, you did this and you did that and you did the other thing, Ms. Employee or Mr. Employee. And of course, you're always looking in the rearview mirror. And through our own surveys, we've seen that employees desire something that's a lot more enriching than that. They want to be looking to the future. They want to know how they can change their behavior and improve their behavior so that they're going to maximize their chances of future success. So career management looks to the future, and it's nothing essentially very special. All it is tweaking that performance conversation to a career conversation in terms of, okay, Ms. Employee, where do you need to get to? Where do you need to go in your career? What are you looking to do, and how can we help you get there? What are the things that we can provide? How are the ways that you need to change your behavior to maximize your own particular career goals? And by shifting the conversation to a future-looking conversation, we're starting the process essentially of building the blocks that an employee is going to need to manage their own career and to help them identify and realize their own career goals. So there's three techniques that may look to some of you as something that you've seen before. Of course, L&D is something that we pretty much all practice. And in terms of learning and development, what I'm going to talk about today is really what our research has shown is really at the forefront in terms of trends in learning and development. I want to talk more essentially about two things. Job crafting. Now, job crafting, you may or may not have heard of job crafting, but it really is a very interesting way to help an employee or to help your employees develop the job that they want to have and to fulfill a lot of their aspirations without necessarily absorbing a new or entering into a new position or a promotion for that matter. And what job crafting is very good at doing is it's very good at bringing out skills and competencies that are adjacent to the core competencies required for a specific job, but we never knew an employee even had because it wasn't part of their own job package. So I'm going to talk about job crafting. And I'm going to talk about job shadowing. Now, probably most of you who either have heard of job shadowing in organizations or actually practice job shadowing. But I think it's important to revisit it. Why? Because the best practice organizations that we deal with that have the highest levels of employee engagement are using job shadowing very effectively. And we'll show you what's in it for the organizations, what's in it for the employees, and how that is really translating into tangible employee engagement benefits. So let's start with job crafting. Well, first of all, what is job crafting? It involves, as you see on the screen, redefining one's job to incorporate one's motives, strengths, and passions. So essentially, if you're doing something specific, as part of your job package, no matter if you're the CEO of the organization or in the frontline customer service or in the back office, we can allow employees to redefine their job, essentially to incorporate their own strengths and passions into that job. And that, of course, becomes much more fulfilling to both organization and to employees. So there's three types of job crafting. One is called task crafting, and what task crafting is essentially just the way it sounds. It's about changing the activities in one's job by either taking on more tasks or fewer tasks or expanding or diminishing what the person does. But basically what we're looking at is changing what we do instead of necessarily how we do it. And one example of that is an accountant creating a new method of filing their taxes to make her job less repetitive. So in doing so, we have to remember that the person who does their job every day is the person who knows that job best. And while we tend to think, many managers think that they know best in terms of how certain things can be done, often because we've done it ourselves, we've also lost sight of that over time. And the person who's doing the job is the best and is most suited to making suggestions in terms of how they can change that job, usually to make it more efficient, but also to make it more fulfilling. So task crafting is part of that. And then there's relationship crafting. And relationship crafting is a little bit different because what it does is it changes the extent to which we interact with other people. So for example, here on the screen, a computer technician can essentially offer help to coworkers and develop training programs, for example. I want to do, you know, I just do computer tech or I do tech support, but I can also provide training to teach people how to use different applications more effectively, thus cutting down on the calls that the help desk receives. And of course, that changes the relationship also. It changes the tasks, because there's task crafting involved, but it also changes the relationships that individuals have with each other. We think of the computer tech or the tech support as the computer geek who wants to sit behind their screen. Well, some may want to, but others may want to reach out and have more interaction or less interaction for that matter. And then we think about cognitive crafting, and basically that's doing the same job but thinking about it very, very differently. So for example, a hospital orderly, we've seen this actually up close and personal. Hospital orderlies don't necessarily think, we don't want them to think of their job necessarily as just mopping the floors and keeping their stations clean. We can think of it as essentially providing assistance to the institution in terms of helping people get well by minimizing the amount of bacteria contamination in that workspace. So you can see it's thinking about the same job differently. So there's task crafting, relationship crafting, and cognitive crafting. Those are the three types of job crafting that we most often see. So let me take you through how this actually works. Now, we can do this on a one-on-one basis, and most often organizations who do job crafting don't even realize it because the employee is coming to them and they're saying, I can do my job differently and I can do it better if you let me do it differently. And an open-minded supervisor might be open to changing those tasks. But if we institutionalize that process, and we can do this, we've done this in workshops where we take around 20 people, 20 to 30 people, and we get them to work through this exercise, we can have a major impact on the organization. So the first thing that people do is essentially they map out where they spend their time. So very, very simple diagram in front of you. Where do you spend your most time? So monitoring performance of the team, answering the team's questions, assisting, analyzing, directing, marketing, research. Where do you spend the middle amount of time? Where do you spend the least amount of time? So that's professional development, designing marketing strategies. That's where we spend the least amount of time. And then what we need to do is we need to do some self-reflection. Asking ourselves three questions. Now, it's really important to get employees, when they do this, it's really important to get them to think about not only what's good for them, but how they value add to the organization. How can changing what they do add value not only to their own job package, but also to the organization? Because remember, it's really about an economic transaction at the end of it. Obviously, we want to make this enjoyable and engage the employee in what they're doing. But fundamentally, that has to add more value to the organization and their colleagues around them in order for it to work. So we ask yourselves, what do you value? I value enjoyment, I value meaningful relationships, what do you value in the work that you're doing for this organization? And then really, what are the key strengths that you bring? I bring knowledge of the field, I bring people skills, and what is really that you're most passionate about? Passionate about learning the latest technology. I share this passion about teaching others. Essentially, I can give you my own personal example of how I've crafted my own work essentially to do these webinars because I enjoy the teaching aspects so much of what I do in terms of helping organizations improve engagement. I love to teach. So I love to do the workshops and I love to do the webinars. So essentially that's my passion, and that's the passion, we've built that into my own job package. Now, of course, someone with my experience, we could do that. You can take those initiatives. Someone with less experience needs a lot more coaching and help to realize that. But essentially what we need to ask employees to do, whether it's in a workshop or on a one-on-one, ask themselves what they value, ask themselves what they're good at, and ask themselves what they're passionate about. And then they can recraft their own job by essentially inserting those values, strengths, and passions into their own job package. So for example, here we've got essentially the same role. We continue to do the same tasks, but what our role is empowering the team to do its best rather than just providing that technical and marketing support. What we're doing is we value meaningful relationships. We're really good at one-on-one communication. We have a passion for teaching others. So we can change the way we think about our role in terms of, you know, instead of being a marketing coordinator, we can think about our role as someone who empowers the team. And then we can build on that essentially, you know, with personal growth, with tech savvy, that's one of their key strengths. They can use that to teach their colleagues. Essentially, they can use and help them teach and learn new technology. So that's just a very rudimentary example of how job crafting actually works. So then I'm going to move on to job shadowing. And job shadowing is something that's pretty intuitive. I mean, essentially what it boils down to is having somebody follow someone around through a day, through a week, to learn what they do. And job shadowing is most often used to train somebody into a new job role. But job shadowing essentially can be used for much more than that, and it has much greater potential, not only for employee engagement, but also in terms of breaking down silos. So, you know, there's a lot of benefits that we overlook when we're looking at job shadowing. We tend to use those organizations that do use it in a very, very narrow scope. In other words, train the employee to do the job, let them do the job, leave them alone to do the job. Whereas what we're missing out on a lot if we just take that approach. So for staff, for departments, for the organization, It's really an opportunity for self-development. It's an opportunity to share best practices. It's an excellent networking tool, but it breaks down internal barriers. By having someone shadow someone in another department, what we're doing is we're giving that person a sense of empathy in terms of what someone in that other department is doing. And that's one of the key benefits for the job shadower, but what it does is it translates to a better communication between different departments, and what that's actually doing is breaking down silos. And we've had in a number of focus groups that I've conducted recently for a number of clients, we've had employees provide those anecdotes in terms of how job shadowing has essentially benefited them, given them a leg up in their career, because if you look at them in a competitive situation with a colleague, they've now got a more rounded view of the organization, having worked or having job shadowed somebody in another department or other departments. So they're gaining a lot of new insight. They're testing out possible career options. The host, what's in it for the person who's being shadowed? Often we get resistance from the people who are being shadowed. Oh no, I got to have somebody tagging along with me today. Well, there are a lot of benefits for that person individually as well. We need to remind them of that when we institute these job shadowing programs. Networking with colleagues from other areas, sharing their experiences with others. There's nothing more than an experienced employee likes to do than share that experience. Innately, people love to demonstrate that they have a skill, a knowledge, and level of experience that they can impart to others. And they can also learn from the shadowee. They can learn from that person who's shadowing about that other department, about, oh, we do it this way over here. That's interesting, you do it that way over there. And that kind of interaction. And it also helps develop coaching and mentoring skills amongst the people who are more experienced. So as we can see, there's really not much of a downside to this. The only downside is the very, very temporary loss of someone's time doing their regular job. But when we see that we can invest a day, 2 days maybe, of that person's time into an experience such as this, we can see that there's going to be huge spin-offs in the future. And many organizations that have the high engagement scores that everybody strives to are actually doing some sort of job shadowing in a more formalized and institutionalized way. So the process itself is pretty straightforward. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this particular slide, but if we have a job shadowing program in place, we advertise that within the org, we communicate that within the organization, and then we basically take individuals who are expressing interest, we schedule accordingly to make sure that resource requirements are met, and then we just basically set it up the line manager, set up the job shadower, the host, and essentially we make sure that the organization knows that that's actually going to be taking place. And it does take place, but most importantly, what doesn't happen very often is a debrief with both host and job shadower in terms of the experience itself. And so we can have a continuous learning process in terms of how to make it more effective. And now I want to talk a little bit about learning and development. Learning and development, training programs, I mean, these are the biggest tools, the biggest weapons in our arsenal to improve learning and growth opportunities in the organization is providing learning and development. So what is going on? What are some of the best practices that are out there that our best organizations are undertaking? And what are some of the trends that we're seeing in terms of L&D? Well, before I get into those, I think it's really important to understand that there's a number of underlying forces that are driving these trends. And I think when I talk about this, this is not going to be foreign to many people. The first underlying force is there needs to be, especially since, I guess, building in the year over the 2000s, but really coming to a head in the 2008-09 recessionary period, was a fundamental, really strong need to demonstrate the return on investment for training investment. Because it was often seen as we would put number of people into a classroom for a day. There's a cost to doing that. There's a cost to delivering the training. There's a cost to bringing the trainers in. And where was the return on that investment? Very, very difficult to measure from a productivity standpoint. For those of you who are familiar with learning and development and adult learning might understand what the Kirkpatrick's level three, level one, two, three evaluations consist of. I won't go into those in this particular webinar essentially, but a level three evaluation comes close to measuring the behavior change that takes place about 6 months after the training takes place, so we can see if there's behavior change or desire that behavior change. But fundamentally, what we're talking about here is there's an increased pressure to demonstrate that return on investment. Where's that coming from? That's coming from cost pressures. Organizations have to make decisions in terms of where to allocate their resources. And before they allocate their resources in a big way in learning and development, they have to basically see what that investment is going to provide, because there's essentially different costs. And I think most fundamentally for the learning and development industry is we used to say, okay, we can send someone to training and we can be fairly confident that people will incorporate the learning over time. Well, the patience has run out on that, and what organizations need to see, for better or for worse, is a need for immediate behavior change. We need to see the skill implemented immediately during and following the training. No longer are we going to train someone and hope over time that they're going to implement that skill. We need to see it right away. And by the way, job shadowing is probably one of the most effective ways to do that immediate behavior change. And a key principle in adult learning, as many of you know, is adults learn by doing. So job shadowing is an awesome way to get people to do something very, very quickly. But what that's doing is it's influencing the trends that we're going to talk about next. Of course, we all know that the online, the internet, e-learning is taking a foothold. It's a much more efficient way of delivering learning. Effectiveness can vary, but definitely efficiency and cost is reduced by putting training, learning, and development online. What it also does is it allows individuals to learn at their own pace. But more recently, as we need to get that learning onto a mobile platform. And many organizations understand this intuitively. A lot fewer organizations are implementing it. Why? Well, because the adult learning, the folks who have the skills in developing the content do not necessarily have the skills in terms of translating that content into a mobile platform. So we need an interaction with an IT community, and we don't see that very often. But nonetheless, putting that learning, putting that content, putting those courses and those learning opportunities into a mobile environment is really where many, many organizations are going. And part of that is really responding to how the new generation who grew up on the internet, the millennial generation, is learning. How did they learn? They learned a lot more online than we did in our generation, in the boomer and Xer generation. So we basically need to adapt to those. It's not only from a cost perspective, but it also is adapting to the new generation. And of course, that's the third trend as well, adaptive learning, which allows for learning at one's own pace. Essentially, it's simplified, but that's basically what we're talking about. And just like we're talking about putting learning and development online, we need to understand the impact of social media on learning and development, not only from content perspective, but also from a delivery perspective in terms of how social media can be used as a learning and development delivery tool. Things like corporate social media platforms like Yammer, like SharePoint. Understanding how we can use those as tools. Organizations are incorporating social media into their learning to broaden the learning audience. So if someone we can get a small group of individuals that learn very intensely, they can essentially transmit or translate that learning or multiply it through the multiplier effect using social media. Business objectives and aligning business with business objectives is becoming paramount. We need to show a direct link between where the organization is going strategically in terms of what vision it needs to achieve, what competencies are required from our people to achieve that vision, and what how we fill those competency gaps with learning and development, that has to be a linear equation. So aligning with business objectives is really, really key. And of course, since return on investment is so important, we need to be able to measure the effectiveness of that training. And for right now, probably the most effective way of doing that is essentially to measure the behavior change that results from a learning and development session. And if anybody wants to Google Kirkpatrick's Level 3 training evaluation, they can see very clearly how to do that. I think probably the most fundamental shift that's happening now in terms of learning and development is we're moving away from the classroom and we're moving to increased on-the-job or skills training. We're replacing the corporate trainers with former employees because former employees are the ones that know the skills best and the organization best. And I've seen this firsthand in many of our public sector clients who have very unique mandates. I'll take one particular, Global Affairs Canada. Essentially, I used to do a lot of training in that organization as a trained facilitator and workshop organizer and someone with experience in employee engagement and management. But as time has progressed, a lot of the skills that those individuals require as diplomats are best taught by former diplomats. So we see a lot of former employees from these organizations now teaching these or providing the learning. And essentially what they're doing is they're learning the skills in terms of adult learning and education rather than the trainers trying to learn the skills of the diplomat, which takes a lot longer and is a lot more difficult to do. Personal coaching is really coming to the fore as we see, I wouldn't say an explosion, but definitely an increase in the number and effectiveness of 360 evaluations and the personal coaching that goes along with management development. The value of a personal coach and executive coach is becoming much more recognized by organizations. Many organizations are including personal or executive coaching in their employee development plans, in their employee benefits packages as well. So that's really coming to the fore. And I've also really talked about the movement away from classroom time, which is unfortunate because a lot of people, especially the older generation, this is how the older generation knows how to learn. And many are having more difficulty with shifting that learning to online. But the fact remains that there's fewer classroom hours where we take many people at the same time, put them into a classroom and teach them for a day or two, or even a week. And all of that content is moving to an adaptive online social media platform. So those are some of the things that are happening in the learning and development sphere. So basically, I've covered most of the content just for your own reference. And while some of you put some questions into the questions box and allow me to answer, I'll just tell you where we're going to be in the next few months. In Montreal, we'll be at the Congrès de 2016 International Francophone des Ressources Humaines at Palais des Congrès from September 8th and 9th. So visit some of our Quebec friends. We'll be at the HR Executive Technology Conference in Chicago in October, the People Analytics Summit in Toronto in November, Canada's Top Employer Summit as well in November. We'll also be doing what's not on this slide. We'll be doing a number of workshops together with the Conference Board of Canada. They've just been relayed to us, so we'll update that slide for our next month's webinar. But we'll be doing workshops on employee engagement with the Conference Board of Canada in Halifax and in Edmonton. Dates to be determined. One will be in late October. The other, I believe, is November 17th in Edmonton, to be confirmed. For more information on that, just feel free to contact me or any of my colleagues here on this slide. As I check our question box, and I see it's been very, very clear today, so we don't have any questions at this particular time. Just for those of you who would like a copy of this webinar discussion, the The URL is at the bottom of this page, so just go to talentmap.com/webinar-past, or you should be able to find it under talentmap.com, and then go to the resources page of our website. So on that note, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your attention today. It's been a pleasure talking to you, and I'm hoping to see more and more of our clients implementing things like job shadowing, job crafting, and augmenting the learning and development programs, all in the quest for better professional growth and, of course, improved employee engagement. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful day.